Hello, let's talk about trees in our course data structures. We will see trees in general, then we will focus on binary trees that show up frequently. There is also this binary search trees, a variation of a binary tree. It is also very common, popular, you will see that. There will also be self-balancing binary search trees that we call AVL trees or red-black trees. So we will focus on AVL trees, but not on this class today to keep this around 1 hour. So we will talk about self-balancing trees, binary search trees, in a different day. So a tree is basically a set of nodes and edges that connect these nodes. So I can summarize it quickly as follows. These nodes are connected in such a way that there will be no cycles within this assembly. Also, everything will be connected, so there won't be any disconnected part of the tree, meaning that given a node, I can go to any other node, so it is connected, okay? And there won't be any cycle. So if you are familiar with graphs, a tree is a graph, but it's a special graph where it is connected and it doesn't have any cycle. Okay, it's as simple as that. So now let's get serious with the definitions and all. So we have a node, so maybe I can come in here. This is a node, and it may have some children below it. Then this node is not T, is the parent of this child C1 and C2. So it can be, there can be a number of children, C3, etc. So I'm talking about trees in general. And so what is it saying here? N nodes, N minus 1 edges. So since I don't want a cycle, N nodes and N edges will create a cycle for sure with the pigeonhole principle. So I need to miss one edge. Also, I need to keep N minus 1 edge to keep everything connected. So, okay, so I already have a slide here for that, for the terminology. So node A is the parent of B, C, D, E, F, and G, or leaves. Leaf is an important concept. It's a node without any children like I or L. And siblings are nodes that share the same parent, like K, L, M are siblings, like brothers or sisters. There will be a path, an important definition, from nodes N1 to NK, which is a sequence of nodes, where every node Ni is the pair, where the node Ni follows, so node Ni plus 1 follows Ni, so it means that Ni is the parent of Ni plus 1, okay? So let's see a path A, E, J, P, okay? So this is a path where J follows E, so meaning that E is the parent of J. Length of the path is the number of edges on that path. So A, E, J, P, so we got stuck with this path for some reason. Then this path has a length of 3, 1, 2, 3, I will count the number of edges. Okay, so I can, okay, so this path I'm talking about here, it has 1, 2, 1 edge, 2 edge, and 3 edges, so it has, this path has a length of 3. Depth of a node is the length of a path from root to that node, okay, so how deep it is in my world. So depth of node J is the length of a path from root, in this case root is this one, the top node. So I will take this path A, E, J. What's the length of this path? 1 and 2. 2. So depth of J is 2. And by the way, there are these directions in my edges, which is not necessary, because by convention we will put the root on top, so meaning that everything will go from top to bottom. Okay. So in general, we don't really put directions when we draw tree edges. Height of a node is the length of the longest path from node Ni to a leaf. Okay, so be careful. Depth of a node is the length of the path. There is only one path from root to a node. Okay, only one path, so I don't need to go with the longest or shortest. There is only one path, so let's remember there is only one path from A to J, which is this. Okay, so its depth of J is 2, but height of J is the longest path from J to a leaf. Okay, so there may be many. In this case, there are two leaves here, and all the paths have a length of 1, so height of J is just 1. So let's take the height of A, the root, which makes the height of the tree, by the way. So height of A is, there are many leaves that I can reach from A. So I can go to C, I can go to M, etc. But I will take the longest path, which will bring me to Q or P, it doesn't matter. So I will take 1, 2, 3. So height of A is 3. And then one last definition is, if there's a path from N1 to N2, so N1 is on the top, meaning that N1 is his ancestor, like bigger, older than N2. And similarly, N2 is descendant of N1. Okay, so we already have a slide about that. Not about the ancestor thing, but about the height and depth recap. So let's take a random node, like, I don't know, D. The height of D, it's not a good choice, is the length of the longest path from D to a leaf. There is only one alternative, which is this, so it is 1. But this may be interesting. Height of E is, I can go to I or K, which are leaves. Remember, the nodes without any children. But going to I will cost me only 1 step, but going to K will cost me 2 steps. So I will go with the longest path, longest choice. So height of E would be 2. Nice. And depth of E is 1, because I will go to root, and there is a unique path from root to any other node. In fact, from one node to any other node, there is a unique path in a tree. So let's, for the rewording E, I will take this path. It has a length of 1, so height of depth of E is 1. Similarly, depth of J is 2, because A to J is 2, etc. So how do we keep a general tree, not a binary tree, be careful, a general tree in memory in our code? We will have a tree node, just like linked list node or stack node, etc. So this node will contain its value element, which is very important. Also, it will have pointers, two pointers. One points me to my first child, and then pointers to the next sibling. So in this example, so let's draw this tree. And why am I losing this every time? I don't know. So A has the first child of B, then B, the next siblings. So these are the siblings of B. So meaning that they share the same parent as B, which is A. So B, C, D, E, here, and F and G. So this is the first layer of my tree. See, I can just keep this in my memory like this, using these two pointers. Then B doesn't have any first child to point to, so okay. But C also, but D has a first child, so I have this H here. Similarly, E has I and J, be careful, this is the next sibling, etc. So it can go like this. So let's implement a useful function, which is used a lot in operating systems. How do I learn the size of a given directory? So this code, so directories are implemented as trees in the background, okay? Then I can use this recursive code to list, sorry, this is about ls, this is listing the directory with some indentation, Okay, so given this director structure, I should end up with this terminal with the prints like that. So Mark is the parent, then comes the books, courses, and login, which are the children. So they have the same indentation of one tap, and then DSAA, data structures and algorithms, I guess it is two taps further away because it is in the level two. So how can I do this? Basically, this code does it. So I start the recursion with, I give the root, okay, which is mark, and the depth is zero. The depth of the root is zero. So I will print. So this is the action. I do the action immediately. Print mark with zero tap in front of it. So it just comes here. Then, since mark is a directory, for each child, I will do the same because this is a subtree, and as the name implies, it is also a tree. So this is a subtree, right? Subtree of my tree rooted at mark. Similarly, this is a subtree of this subtree. Okay, so there are many subtrees. So there are many trees within a tree. We call them subtrees. That's why trees are very friendly for recursion, because we are always talking about the smaller version of the same problem. So here, let's see this in action. Mark is printed. Okay, so this is done. Then comes the calls to books, courses, and login. So this is just a hidden folder with dot in front of it. But be careful. When I call the books here, the recursion stack keeps also courses and login, but it doesn't print courses because books itself will cause other prints. So when I come here with books, and also be careful, depth plus one. So depth was zero. I come it with one indentation. So books is printed with one indentation in front of it. Then I print it, and then since books is also a directory, I will print all its children: DSAA, ACP, IPPS. Okay, but once DSAA starts, they will just be remembered for later access. DSAA also needs to do other things like printing chapter 1 and chapter 2. Then once I am done with them, then so that for loop has done with DSAA, and then it does the same for ECP. Okay, so this is the logic here, and this logic will be very common. It will be called post or sorry, pre-order processing, because pre means first do the process the node, the root, the current node, and then do the children. So first node, then children. So pre means do the node first. Here, doing means printing. We will also see the opposite, post order. So in the post order, first do the children, then do the node. So the work at a node is done after doing the children. Okay, so let's see this in action. And here is another popular application in operating system: size of a given directory. So let's implement this here. Inside parentheses, you see numbers. These are the sizes. So ones for directories by default. And when I am with a file here, so these are PDFs, for instance, they have none one values like 4 bytes, 6 bytes, etc. But you need to put all these ones in your sum as well. So what I say is this little subtree has the size of 1 plus 4 plus 6, which is 11. Okay. So with that logic, so actually it is also here. So with that logic, you will count all the directory overheads as well as file sizes. Okay, so it turns out to be 52 here, but let's see how we get there. So total size, so size of, I begin with mark. Size of mark is 1. So this is just given. You don't do anything here. So what I will do is actually, since mark is a directory, the total to be returned is this. It is 1 plus. So the total is not done yet because there are something pending here. What are those pendings? These are the children to be processed. So you will call size of books plus size of courses plus size of dot login. Okay, so these are the children of Mark. Once I get them, once I am done with them, once I process them, then and only then I will be able to understand the value of Mark by adding this value to those children sum. So in this case, I will be adding, so and with the same recursive argument, this directory books is also a directory, so it will do the same for itself. So it will learn the value 17 for it. Then, the books will do, and it will learn the value 41 for it. So this will be 41, and courses will learn the value of 8 for it, and dot login will learn the value of 2 for it, and we will sum all these things up, which will make 10, 41, 51, and then the plus one waiting here. So see, the root has finished at last, because I processed that node once I am done with all the children. So 52 is arrived. Okay, so this is called post order. So let's be clear about this pre-order, post-order business. Here is the summary, okay? For the pre-order, you first do the job at that node V. You visit it. Here, we did a printing here, but you can do go anything. You can go wild with it. Then you process the node, then do the children, okay? So recursively. See, this is recursion. Visit, and then for the children, call pre-order again. And for the post-order, first do the children recursively, and then do the node that has triggered these recursions. Okay, so this is post visit, this is pre visit. So in this example, the pre-order traversal of this scene, of this tree, would be like this. First do it, okay, one. So these are the timestamps, one, and then children, two. But don't do the next children, because this also has other children like 3 and 4. So I am now done with this. So go to the second children of 1, which is 5 here. Then it triggers 6, 7, 8. Once I am done with it, now do the latest children in the end, 9. For the post-order version of the same, not the same tree. Okay, it is the same tree, but content is different. I start with here, but I don't do the print here because I can't reach here. All the recursions will prevent me. So from here, I go to the children, which has another children. Now it doesn't have other children below it. So I come here, visit it. So one. So one. This is done. Then come back here. It has the other children, two. So all the children is done, now I can do it. Now I can get rid of homeworks, which is 3. So come to here, but don't print it because it is pending children below it, which is programs. It is also a subtree with stuff below it. So go below 4, 5, 6. Once all the children of programs are done, finish the programs at time 7. So this is also done. This was already done. Now go to the next child of 9, which is 8, and once it is done, eventually print the root. So this the root will be printed in the end, visited in the end. There is also something called in-order traversal. This is valid for binary trees only, because I need to put this visit processing in between the children. To define it, I need 2 children at most. Okay, so left and right. First do the left, then do the visit, then do the right. So what does it mean is, here I start here, but it has a left. Go to left, it also has a left. Go to left, so print this one. It doesn't has a left. So then go here, which is the root. So do the visit here too, then do the right. Okay, so left, root, right. Okay, left, root, right. So this left is done, root is now done for, then right. But don't do it because it has a left. So left is 5, left of it is none. So root is 5 printed, right is 6 printed, Then left of 7 is done. 7 times 7. Then right is 8. And I am done. Okay, so let's get into binary trees. We have already gone there with the in order traversal, but binary tree is a special tree where every node can have no more than two children. So no node can have more than two children. Okay, 0, 1, 2 is okay, but 3 and more are forbidden. Okay, so that is the logic. Then this, since I now have this two upper bound in my hand, I can just do left and right pointers. Okay, previously I don't have the number of children below me, so I can't do it. So B is the left child of A, and E is the left right child of C, etc. So I is a leaf because it doesn't have a left or right child. F is also a leaf, etc. So we can evaluate algebraic expressions stored in trees using in-order traversal, right? So remember, in the in-order traversal, I was using this pattern: left, root, right. So left A, root, right A minus B. Do the same: left, root, right, but it has a left like B, then root, then right. And similarly, left, root, right, so this is done, and then root is done, and then the right is done, etc. So this is called in-order traversal, not pre-order. Okay, what is the height of a binary tree then? There is a nice recursive formula for this, which can be coded easily. Height of a, so for the empty tree, we define it as minus 1, so it will make sense when we discuss self-balancing binary search trees. But for now, if you are not given a tree, you will return minus 1. For a non-empty tree, this is the formula. You will look at the height of the left subtree, okay, Tilia, it's a value, like 10. Height of the right subtree, you will also look at like 15. Then you will add, you will take the max of it, 15, because this is taller. So I will take the max value, which is 15. But then I also need to add 1 to it, because I will connect root to either left or right using one step, one edge. So in this case, this is a height of 1, 2, 3. So same content, but different heights are possible. So and this will... so this is a balanced tree where the height of left and right are quite similar. Actually, they are the same here. But here, left is heavier. It is taller. So I should avoid this. Because in the worst case, I can end up with a tree like this. One node. So everything goes to the left of it, okay? So what I end up with is a linked list type of thing, right? I start from here, and to reach here, I need to advance through all the nodes. But here, to go to E, I can just follow this path, and I get rid of all this processing. Okay, so that's why we need to keep trees as balanced as possible. So maximum height of a binary tree with n nodes in n minus 1, it is that tree that I just draw. So it is also here, right? I have n nodes, and they need to be connected by definition, so I have n minus 1. Edges, and I count the number of edges from root to a leaf. In this case, there is only one alternative, so that will be my height, which is n minus 1. Terrible. So it is a, the height will be on in terms of time complexity. It can be as bad as n, which is happening in this case. Sometimes you may get lucky and your height becomes log n. So if you have 8 nodes, the height would be log 8, which is 3 base 2. So in this case, the 8 node would be this one, so 1, 2, 3, okay, because I am using all the possibilities at each level, so minimum height is also possible. Okay, so let's see this log n thing carefully. So to go there, I need to prove two things to you. First, maximum number of nodes that a binary tree of height 8 can have is this much. So where the hell is this coming from? Maximum number of nodes. So I need to populate it as much as possible. So I will put one node here, to root obviously. Then I will get all the children 2. Each will give me 2, so I will have 2 times 2, 4. Similarly 8, 16, etc. So let's make this count then. 1 plus 2 plus 4 plus blah blah plus. So it will finish. Remember I am talking about a tree with height 8. Okay, it is given. So it will finish at 2 to the power of 8. So just to verify, if my tree was over at this layer, which has a height 1, 2, 3, then I will add 1, 2, 4, 8. So this needs to be 2 to the power of 3. So what is this actually? We can use the following trick. So if I call this value n, so what is 2n then? This is a trick. This is called telescopic series, I guess. 2n is what? 2 times this. So it will be 2 plus 4 plus 8 plus blah blah. I don't write all of them. 2 to the 8 plus 2 to the 8 plus 1, because it is 2 times 2 to the 8. I multiply all terms by 2. Now if I subtract this thing from this thing, so what happens is they cancel away, right? Like in this zigzag manner. And this will also kill this. So in the end, I end up with 2 to the 8 minus 2 to the 8 plus 1 minus this little fellow. Minus 1. So this is how we prove this. Okay. So I just show you that the maximum number of nodes can be this much. So this is useful in the proving of minimum height of a binary tree with n nodes, minimum height. So maximum height was n minus 1. Unfortunately, we have seen this. It was this chain structure. What is the minimum height though? So to get the minimum height, I need to populate every layer as much as possible. So in other words, I will take n equal to this highly populated value that I just proved. Now just arrange terms, n plus 1 is that, take the logs. So you end up with this, h is a logarithmic function on n, plus some details, but I need to show you here is, that is useful to me, is h is o log n, big O log n. Okay, so this is the best case. You can't do better than this. And you should do this actually, not only in the best case scenario, also in the worst case scenario, because of the insert and deletion actions that we will see later. So self-balancing trees will help you do that. That is again a topic of another day. So number of binary trees with the same number of nodes. With two nodes, I can end up with two binary trees. Root and left, root and right. Okay. With three nodes, I will end up with five binary trees. Like symmetric 1 and 2, go all left, go all right, similarly left right or right left, and also root and one left and one right, balanced one. So 5 is the answer here. A full binary tree is a tree in which every node in the tree has either 0 or 2 children. So one child is disallowed. So this is okay because it says 0 children, it's a leaf. This is okay, it has 2. This is okay, it has 2. So this is a full binary tree. Yes, this is also a full binary tree of height 2. So to get the height of a binary tree, you will get the height of the root. Again, remember, height is the longest path from root to a leaf. So in this case, it is obviously 2. But in this case, longest path so from root to a leaf. So I will not select this leaf because it's not longest, but I will select this leaf. 1, 2, 3. So height of this tree is 3. Okay. Complete binary tree is completely filled at each level except the last level, which is filled from left to right. Okay. So what I mean is if I add this node, for instance, this is not complete anymore because okay, I can miss something in the last layer, but I shouldn't miss this thing. It has left, although it is weird, but let's say it is left. Then you also should put right to it, and then you can begin putting this. So this is currently a complete tree, and also this tree isn't complete either, because then I have a new layer here, first, second, third, fourth, fifth layer, but I haven't finished the fourth layer yet, so this is not complete. Even if I have given you this binary tree with the nice thing happening in the last level, it is still not complete because I am missing something in the previous levels. So to make it complete, I need to put this as well. Again, so this is complete, etc. Full but not complete. Okay, so again, completeness go away because I am in this fourth layer, but there is some thing missing in the beginning of this last layer. So where are these guys? Okay. Neither full nor complete. Okay, so it is not full because this node has one child. It is not allowed. And obviously it's not complete because it's this level should be filled from left to right. Where is the left guy, etc. Full and complete. Yeah. Okay, so let's implement binary trees. Now it is similar to our first tree nodes in the beginning of this class. Now I will just use binary node, not a general tree node. It will again have the element in it, the value. Then it will have a pointer to left and right. If it has only one child below it, then one of these guys will be null. Not a big deal. So again, so traversal of binary trees, you can follow this logic. So this is, since I have only at most two children here, I can do this shortcut. For preorder, do root, then left, then right. Okay, for in order, left, root, right. And for post order, left, right, root. So with that, here 60, go left, this is printed, then go left, 10, it is printed, then go right of this, because there is nothing further below. Go right 4, then 5, 6, this is done. Okay, root was done, left is done, and now the right of the root is done, 7, 17, then. In order, first go as left as possible, this thing, then the root of it, then go right, but don't print it because it has a left. First do this, then do the root, L, R, then right. Left, root, right. So left is done, root is now done, and finally right is done, 7. And here, left, right, root. So go left, left, left here. Go to root, but don't print root because I am not in this mode. I am in left, right, root mode. So go to right of it, which is the left, so print this. Then for this subtree, left, right, root, it is done. Left is done, right is done, root is done, 5. So left is done, now do the right, 6, and then the root, which is 7. Implementing this is extremely simple. Preorder, again, first the root, whatever the current root of the current subtree is. So it is P here. Do the visit, in this case I am just printing. And then do the same recursively on left and right. In order, just change the order of recursion, okay? Left root, right? And post order, left right root. Let's see an even better application of this. So here I think I am happening left root, left, right, okay? So it looks like a preorder traversal. But why am I traversing this tree? To find the maximum value in the whole binary tree. So the logic is the following. I will take the root. Okay, so let's see the big picture first. It is root wall, 2. 2 versus the max of the left subtree, okay? Whatever it is. So I will have 3 numbers when I will come here. Then max of the right subtree of 2. So max of, So max of left versus max of right. So there will be some recursive action happening here, but assume that I survived all those recursions. So this will give me what? What is max of L? I will keep it in this variable called left. Max of right subtree will be kept in this variable called right. Then I will have, this is the basic iterative part, where you have three variables, left, right, and root val. So root val is 2, left in this case would be 11, right? So I can just see it as a human being. The left, max of the left is 11, and max of the right subtree is 9. It's has only one candidate anyway. So I will come here with 2 versus 11 versus 9, and in the end, so what these 6 lines do is they will select the max of the 3 elements. So if left is bigger than right, max is left. Then if root is even bigger than that max, then root is the max, etc. So it's just simple. So in this case, 11 will be returned. But let's forget about the magic for a second and derive this. So max L, so let's begin, let's redo everything. 2, I start with root 2. 2 is in my pocket, it is easy, root val is 2. Then left is find max of this left of 2. So find max in this tree, okay? So this tree now the control is in this tree. I will forget about it. When I am done with this, I will take the control on the right subtree of 2, which is this. So let's do this because it is easy. So what is the value here? Okay, 9 will, okay, find max p dot right. So it will, I will call here with 9 in my p. Okay, so now p is not null. Okay, root is 9. Okay, 9. What is the left of 9? So versus, I will call p dot left. So 9 dot left is null. Be careful. So when I come here with null, p is null, so I can't enter the recursive block. I will just return max, which is initially set to minus 1. So I will have 1 minus 1, okay, due to left. Due to right of 9, I will have another null coming here. Okay, so this is null now. Max is minus 1, so it will be returned. So the max of the right subtree will be 9 versus minus 1 versus minus 1. It will be 9. So this is set, okay. I have just unresolved the magic in the right recursion. So I will not do the left here then. It's the same tactic. It will give me the magical 11, just like it did for 9. Then 2 versus 11 versus 9, the answer will be 11. Okay, so same logic. Now I will add all the values once I am traversing it in pre-order manner in this case as well. Again, the names don't really matter, pre-order, post-order, but you should understand the logic happening here. So what is the sum of this binary tree? It begins with root 2, so since it is not null, it will be 2 plus, just like the max before, I will call add recursively on the left, plus I will do add recursively on the right. So recursive add on the left will give me, I know that, what will it give me? 11, 16, 22, 31. And recursion here will give me 9. I know that. So the answer will be eventually 42. So let's do this recursion again. It is simple. So add left will do its thing, okay, it will cause other recursive calls, etc. It will eventually lead to 31. Then the turn comes to add for 2 dot right, which is 9. So let's see what happens here. Add 2 dot right, which is 9. So add 9. So I come here with 9 in my pocket, okay. 9 is not null. So what I will do, it will cause this thing. 9 plus, because of this, plus add of, what is the left of 9? It is null. Add of null plus Similarly, add of another null, because right of 9 is also null. So when I come here with null in my pocket, it will just give me 0 by definition. This is the base case. Okay, 0. So 9 plus 0, and I am done with that recursion. And similarly, 0. So 9 plus 0 plus 0. So I get my 9 here. So I just result unfolded this recursion for you. So what if I have returned 1 here as a pop quiz or something? Then instead of returning 0, I would be adding 1s. It is interesting to think about this. What will you end up with? You will have some excessive amount. Actually, every leaf will contribute to 1. Will contribute 2. Okay, so you will get your sum plus number of leaves times 2. More exercises can follow. How can I count the leaves of a binary tree? Let's talk about this. Again, so I have a binary tree. So, okay, this is a binary tree. I don't have a copy here. So let's keep it like this. So in this case, the answer is the number of binary trees in the left plus number of nodes, leaves in the left, plus number of leaves in the right. So in this case, 0 plus 2, it will be 3. Your answer will be 3. So, but why did this happen? When you are given nothing, null, it will return 0, no contribution. But when you give me a node which has neither left nor right child, like this node, it will return 1. Okay, so here I will return 1. And similarly, I will come here. It is not a special node. It will just call the left recursion on the left and right. And this is a special thing. It will collect 1 from here and another 1 from here. So it will, since I sum them up, it will collect 2 here. Now, for the root, that was the beginning of everything, it has collected 2 here for the right. So 2 here. And it has collected 1 from the left. So the answer will be 3. How about counting only the left leaves? Give me the count of the left leaves. So is there a trick we can do in this code here? Let's think about it for a second. So in this example, it would count this leaf because it's a left leaf. And it will also count this leaf because it's a left leaf, left of this thing. Not this. So answer would be 2 in that case. But how can I implement this? Let's think about it. First of all, I will get contribution. Maybe I will probably get a boolean here, boolean in my function call, boolean is left, IL. Okay, so a stupid name, but IL is left. So when I do the get leaf count call, since I am going to left here, the second parameter will be true because I am going to the left of the current node. So is left is true, but for the right I will send false because I am going to right, so I am probably here and I am going here, so it is not a left leaf. I will send a false here, so is leaf will be false. So to get that in my life, I will put another AND condition here and I will do the contribution only if is left is true, IL is true. So I will just add these 4 characters here. Okay, it's a simple solution that comes to mind instantly. There may be others. Write a function that will find the height of a binary tree. Okay, so height of an empty binary tree is -1. For the other key, let's go with this example. It will be height of the left binary tree, left subtree, and I will look at the height of the left subtree and height of the right subtree. I will take the max of it. I think the max is happening here. So if left is bigger, left is the max. I will add 1 to left. Okay, so what this here does is actually in our code, it is like max 1 plus, because 1 is always there. 1 plus max of, I am calling the max function of math library or something, L depth. comma, R depth. So I would prefer this call instead of these three lines anyway. And that is done actually. So let's see how it is done. This minus one is important here because when I start from here as my root, the answer will be, it's not null. I will come here. It will be the height of left, whatever it is, and height of right, whatever it is, plus one. So what is the height of left? So I will come here. Let's call this node A. I will come here with A. A is not null. Okay. So I will do the following. Go to the left of A, which is null. So when node is null, I will return minus 1. This is very important here because there will be a plus 1 in the end. So I will have minus 1 contribution from the left child. And for the A, I will get another minus 1 contribution from the right child. So these are not contributions. I will select the max of 2 minus 1s. It will be just a minus 1. And plus, there is also a plus 1 waiting for me in any case. So plus 1. So what just happened? For this node, height has been 0, which is wonderful because height of this node was 0. So don't see the stuff that I have written. Initial tree was like this. Height of this node is 0 by definition. Height of this node would be 1. Okay, this node would be 1. So how did that happen? Because I was here. So let's do the height of this node. Okay. Let's call this node B then. So I call here with B. What is the... So I call recursion on the left child. So height of this node would be... So what would that be? It will be this case, right? It will call other functions with minus 1, and when you add plus 1, it will get 0 from here. Similarly, it will get 0 from here. 0, 0, max is 0, plus 1. So height of this node is plus 1. Now let's write everything from scratch. Height of that node was 0, so this is value, and height of this node was 1. These are values. This is the node, so let's paint this. And final height of this node will be select the max, which is this, add 1 to it, so the answer will be 2. By the way, you can... This also just came to my mind. If you are at a leaf, which you can detect by this tactic, right? It's already here. So this is how you detect whether you are at a leaf node or not. Then you can just return 0. It will save you until hitting this minus 1. Okay, so this can make the code a little bit faster, but this is really not a big deal. Return 0 if you are at a leaf. If you are at an empty thing, non-defined, then you should return minus 1. So these return values are very important. Let's do the BST then, binary search tree. It is a binary tree, no panic here, but it is a special binary search tree where for a given node, everything in the left subtree will be smaller than this node, and everything in the right subtree will be bigger than this node. So once I started here, for this node, this holds. And it should hold for all nodes. For this node, everything in the left subtree, so 2, 1, 4, 3, it must be smaller than the parent. And everything in the right subtree must be bigger than the parent. So this is a binary search tree, in short. But this is not that because of... So this part is a binary search tree, this subtree, wonderful, because 4, 3 is smaller, 7 is bigger. But be careful, this part... There's a problem. This is the node. In the left subtree, everything must be smaller than 6, but there's a 7. So, not a binary search tree. For the same data, you can end up with this linked list like binary search tree with ON height. It is not efficient. But you can also get a very nice binary search tree, balanced. Okay, so now to come to any node, I need to do just two steps. Here, in the worst case, I need to do n steps. Here, it will be just log n steps, because we just proved in previous slides that the height would be log n in the best case scenario. Okay, so in binary search tree, if you are lucky, in the best case, all operations will be log n, but in the worst, they would be O n. Again, there will be self-balancing binary search trees like red-black trees or AVL trees. And we will see AVL later, not today. In those cases, worst case time is also guaranteed to be log n. Okay, so, but to understand that, let's begin from the basic, like the regular binary search tree. But keep in mind that we never use a regular binary search tree because of this danger. Everything can be linear. So we will use self-balancing binary search trees, but the logic of putting everything smaller to the left and everything bigger to the right applies to all binary search trees. Let them be regular one or AVL one, self-balancing one. So let's implement a binary node then, which has left and right. Initially they are set in the constructor. There will also be an element. Okay, so how do I find a value then? Okay, find. So thanks to the definition, so but I wish I had a binary. So let's take this binary search tree and put it here quickly and come back. So to find, how do I do the find? If I want to find 4, what I do is I click, I begin with 4, and it will always be 4 here, but this node will change. Initially it will be the root 6. So since 4 is smaller than 6, it must be in the left subtree. So do the find on the same value in the left subtree. So what just happened is everything in the right are just killed in one shot. Okay. So it's good news. So what just happened in the left subtree? I come here with 4, but t dot left is 2 now. So I am here with node, this node. So 4 is bigger than 2. So I will execute this statement. Then do the search in the right subtree of this node. Okay, so go to t dot right, which is this node, 2 dot right. So I come here with the node 4. And now see, this is always 4. So since 4 is not smaller than 4, 4 is not bigger than 4, and it's not null. So I return, so I found it. Okay. But what if I was looking for, I don't know, 5 for instance. Okay, let's look at 5. So I was here 4. So 5 is bigger than 4. I will go one more to right. I want to go to right. Okay, so but what just happened here? T dot right is null. So I will come in this execution with null in my pocket. So this will execute return null because 5 must exist somewhere here, but I just hit a null, so I can't go further. There is no match then. Find min. What is special about binary search tree, if you are careful, the minimum is in the leftmost, as left as possible. Because by contradiction, right, if I put it here, then if there is a zero here, it can't be somewhere here because it must be in the left of the most recent minimum. So what you need to do is, you can do it iteratively as well actually, but in this case, as I start with the root, so this is a general case. If there is no null, if I have a left, then go to t dot left. So this t becomes t dot left. Go like this, and then in the end, when I am at this node, when I am at 1, okay, I am here. So call t 1 dot left. So it will call. I came here with 1, do nothing, so I am 1 in my hand. One dot left is null. Yes, it is the case. So I can't go left anymore. So just return one. Don't do any more recursion. You can do it iteratively, actually. Let's do it for the max, because with the same logic, the maximum must be in the right, as must be sitting in a position that is as right as possible. So basically, you will advance t to right, t equal to t dot right, until t dot right is null. Insertion is, you will do a find, and once you can't proceed anymore, you will insert it right there. So to insert 5, I will just look at 5 here, 6, go to left, go to right. Now I want to go to right, but there is nothing right, so you will insert 5 here. What about duplicates? It depends on your application. So if I want to insert 4, I will come here, 4. You see it, you can quit, prevent duplication. Or you will put everything less than or equal to 2 left, then you will go to left. And then you will put 4 here, etc. But let's stick with the idea here first. How about insertion? So let's get this figure again. For some reason, this is not here. Okay, so I should have done this stuff before, but anyway. So 5, I want to insert 5. Start from 6. So I am doing the finding here, okay, just like before. This will be always 5 in this case. 6, so 5 is less than 6. Do the insertion in the, try the insertion in the left subtree. So I will not do anything to the right. Okay, so now 6 dot left is 2, so I come here with 2. 5 is bigger than 2, so do the insertion to the right subtree of it. So I cut out everything, there may be millions of nodes here, they are just gone in one shot. So 2 dot right is 4, I will, this is the node 4. Now be careful, not be careful actually, 5 is bigger than 4, still a regular case. Insert 5 to t dot right, 4 dot right. Now be careful, because I will have a null in my pocket here now, because 4 dot right is null. Don't see this part here yet. So what just happened is, when t is null, it means that I am at a good spot. So I will create the memory, new C++ thing. So I create the memory. Okay, so let's do it in red. And put the 5 as the value, so I'm calling the constructor here, so this is also red. So see how it is getting connected. And left and right of this node is null, because it is just a leaf currently. Null, they are null, nice. So what just happened is, remember this step, just back one step. I was here with 4 as my root, t was 4. And I called this t dot right, because 5 was bigger than 4. So here, be careful, this is call by reference happening here because of this and sign. So whatever I set here as t, t is just a reference for this thing of the color, which is t dot right. So whatever I set here, it will get connected to t dot right. Okay, so this is how we do the insertion. Deletion is also simple. We have 3 cases. If you are deleting a leaf, it is very simple. Just get rid of it, okay? Because there is nothing to heal. Similarly, if you are deleting a node with only one child, just bypass it. So if I delete it, just bypass it, 40 to 42. Okay, so this will be the answer. Similarly, so it doesn't matter it is whether it is left or right. So in this case, it was the right child, so I just connect 40 to 42. Now a node with only I have deleted a node with only a left child, so 45 only had the left child. Okay, so this connection has happened, and 60 only has a right child, which is 70, so I bypass it, 50 to 70. And the more complicated case is deletion of a node with two children, where I need to make a choice. So I will either put, so I will get rid of 40, which has two children. I will either put the minimum of the right subtree here, like 42, or the maximum of the left subtree, like 30. So let's see what happened here. They did the first thing I said, minimum of the right subtree. So 42 will replace 40, and everything below will stay the same. So in this is another example. If I delete Nancy, which has two children, Bob and Tom, so I will put the minimum of the left subtree. So we are doing lexicographic order here, as you can see, initial names. So Nancy, not Wendy, Nancy will go here, okay? Or you could have put the max of the right, which is Alan, right? So Alan can also come here. Then Alan, Bob and Tom, they are compatible, etc. So let's see that activity. Let's get rid of 40 here, okay, which has two children. So let's do it for, so this is the generic code. This will do it for, this will do all the three cases, okay. So this is the two children case, I guess. So let's first do the case where I am deleting a leaf, like 42, okay, or let's delete 70, because I think we have done that. It really doesn't matter a bit, but 70, okay. So let's see the removal of 70 with the codes here. So I will find 70, so x is 70. I begin with 50 root. Since 70 is bigger, I will do the removal on the right subtree, so I will not look at the left at all. So 50 dots right is 60. So this is the node with 60 now. Again, 70 is bigger than 60. So go to right children. So this is the child with 70. Now be careful. X is 70 and I am at node 70. So T is not null, okay. Not smaller, not bigger. And I am at this node. Does it... T dot left isn't null. No, T dot left is null because it's a leaf. So it doesn't apply. I am here. I am at this node. So what just happened here is I am also considering the bypassing case. It won't happen here, but this is a generic code. So alt node is this T, because I will clean the memory later. So now the T is, if there is a left that is not null, then I will use that node. So this is currently T. But in this case, left is null and right is null. So whatever you do, T will be equal to null in the end, okay? Obviously. So T is null, meaning that 60... So I came here by calling 60.right. So 60.right became null. And then I delete that node. So 70 is gone. Now let's delete 45. I will come up to this point. I will come here 40. 45 is bigger, so I execute this. Remove on the right. So, okay, now T is this. Okay. And I am removing 45, not with one child. Now be careful. Not null, 45. So I am, T is not null. It is this node and X is 45. It is not smaller, not bigger, not a leaf because, doesn't have, so this is the case where it has two children, but it has a missing one, so it doesn't apply. Now I am here. Again, remember this node to delete it later with the old node. But now this is the tricky part. This is where the bypassing happens. T is going to be, so if t.left exists, with which it is, so t.left isn't null, then this T will be 42, that not null thing. So at that time I do this connection. Because of call by reference, this T was before T dot right. So 40 dot right became 42. Okay. Bypassing happened. And then I delete the old node. And finally, let's do the tricky part. The node with two children. So let's delete 40. So let's clear the seen to find 40. 40 is smaller than 50, the beginning. So go to left, okay. So T is this now, okay. And I am delete X is 40. Be careful. So it is not null. It is not smaller, not bigger. Now T dot left is not null. Yes, 30. And T dot right is not null. Yes, 45. So I am at this block. So what I will do is I will copy. So I will physically keep this note, because why do I update my structure anyway? I just need a new value here. And that value be the minimum of the right subtree. Okay, so there may be millions of values here. Then I will select the minimum of this right subtree. In this case, it's just 42, obviously. So this element will be 42 then. Okay, so I just called find min that I have implemented before. And I will do the search on T dot right, so on this red region, and I will look for this element, the minimum I am not looking for an element. I will find the minimum, which happens to be 42, and I will get that element value, and I will update it with I will use it to update the element value of the current T, so it became 42. Then, but I am not done yet. At this time, I have this situation going on. 42 here and 42 here. Duplication. So, I will call remove. This is the intelligent part. I will call the same function remove, because it is a removal, and I know that since this is a minimum, it is a leaf, because of the definition of find mean. So, when I call this function again, it will definitely land into this block, guaranteed. So I will remove 42 t dot element that I just set in the right subtree, in this red region. So it will do the removal on the right subtree, and it will remove the first occurrence of 42 because it was the minimum. So it's a very cool code in my opinion. So as we discussed, if you go with a best case configuration, the height would be log n, as we have proved before. So it is best case operation is log n, because remember in all operations, because every operation depends on find, right? You need to find for the insertion, you find 47 and then you insert it. For deletion, you find 42, then delete it. So finding means going through a path. The height, you go through a path which depends on the height of the tree, from root to a leaf with the longest path, because I am taking the longest worst case scenario, and that length is log n. In the best case, and in the worst case, this is on. Okay, so this is a minimum height balanced binary tree, and I don't know the content, so I can't say whether it is binary search tree or binary tree, but it is balanced. This is not balanced. Let's solve a cool statistics problem. How about the number of binary search trees for n that can accommodate n items? So n items can come in n factorial different permutations to me. With those permutations, it is not the answer, obviously. It is not as simple as that, because assume this permutation 2 1 3, then you end up with this binary search tree. But in this permutation 2 3 1, a different permutation but the same binary search tree, so you shouldn't overcount. You should be smart about it. It is not so trivial to count this, because it gets messy quickly, as you can imagine. Apparently for N3, there are 5 binary search trees, which are these guys. I can insert these numbers. And the probability of obtaining this topology is more, is twice than obtaining the other topologies, because it's the example that I have given by coincidence. With six numbers, sorry, with three numbers, there will be six permutations, and two of them will give this to me, so 2 over 6. So this is about probabilities, but let me count the number of possible binary search trees. It can be counted using the Catalan number, which can be derived, but it is a very sophisticated process. It is beyond the scope. The math there is beyond the scope of our class here. So I will solve the same problem with programming using some patterns. Remember, in my Q slides, I have also solved the Josephus problem. There is some math behind it, and in that case, we have derived that math too. But if you are not good at math, you can also solve the Josephus problem using Q data structure. Here, again, I will not do the math to solve it using Catalan numbers. I will do some programming to get the same value. So here is the idea. If you have, let's go with this example. It generalizes, obviously. If you have six numbers in your hand, then, so this function, this for loop, you will put one element to the root and distribute others to left and right accordingly. So when, for instance, 3 is in the root, like the middle element, let's go with numbers 1 to 6, but they don't have to be those numbers. The ordering is important here. If you put 3 to the root, then you must put 2 numbers to the left because of the definition of binary search tree, smaller to the left, and 3 to the right. So basically, when 3 is in the root, which is the case when I is 3, okay, you will get the number of binary search trees with 2 elements, which is NBST recursively, I will learn it, with 2 elements, 3 minus 1 is 2. But for every possibility, so with 1 and 2, I have 2 possibilities. With this possibility, with this binary search tree, there will be this many binary search trees waiting to be constructed. So 3 is here, I had 6 numbers, so 6 minus 3, 3 guys will construct binary search trees. But this is for this configuration. For this configuration, 2, 1, the same value will be computed. This is where the product rule kicks in, actually. That's why I multiply this left factor with the right factor. Okay, so this is the logic. Now let's see this clearly. So why 3 is the root? Anyone can be the root. So I will put all the numbers from 1 to n to my root. So when 1 is in the root, nothing can go to left. So then this will be 0. And when NBST is called with 0, I just trivially return 1. Okay, to keep things working. And to the right of 1, there will be, I don't know, some recursion will tell me, NBST, there will be the number here will be the number of binary search trees with 5 items. 6 minus 1 is 5. So this is one thing, but it is not over. Then I will shift I to 2. When 2 is in the root, there will be NBST 1, so number of binary search trees with 1 item in it. So, but luckily there is an answer to it instantly, base case. When n is 1, there is only 1, return 1, because it is the case. If that value is 66, it is your binary search tree, only 1 alternative. Okay, so 1 times, to the right of this thing, I had n numbers, but I need to get rid of the I, because they were handled here. So n minus I, in this case, 6 minus 2 is 4, so NBST 4. So it will be 4, 1 times NBST 4. Be careful, NBST isn't decided yet. It is just a recursive call, but it will be defined as I come closer to the base case. Similarly, this will be for I equal to 2. For I equal to 3, I will do the same. 2 to the left, 3 to the right. For I equal to 4, I have 3 to the left, 2 to the right. For I equal to 5, I have 4 to the left, 1 to the right. And for I equal to 6, last case, I have 5 to the left and none to the right. So in that scenario, this value will be NBSD 5 times NBSD 0, which is 1. Okay, so that is the logic that helps you, that makes you count the number of binary search trees with n nodes. And here, this is just an efficiency trick. The logic has ended. So this is something called dynamic programming that you will see later in the third class, third year. Basically, you should avoid recomputations. When there is a recursion, you are probably going to recompute stuff a lot. So dynamic programming helps you memorize the pre-computed answers in a table, which happens to be this array in this case. So if that initially that array is minus one all everywhere, so if it is non-decided, do the recursion. There is no way out. But if it is decided later, I want to compute the same value. Since it won't be minus one, I will not call this to recompute it. I will just use that non-minus one value below. And this is the product rule we have seen before. So let me be clear about this a little bit. So NBST, let's call this NB only. NB4, for instance, it will be calling. So there is no 4 here, but. When 4 is in the root, what happened? I could put 3 guys here, and 2 guys here, right? 1, 2, 3 can come here with any, with 1, 2, and 3 will make a binary search tree here, and 5 and 6 will make another binary search tree here, and they will be rooted by 4, which will make the good binary search tree with 4 in the root. So, in other words, I need to compute NBST 4 at some point in my life. So this NBST 4 will call, as you can see, NBST 3. So no recomputation so far. And from the right, it will call NBST 2. Again, no recomputation apparently. But in the next iteration, NB 3, it will call. So it is this configuration, NBST with 3 nodes. It will call, it will put 2 to the left, 1 to the right, for instance. So it would at some point call NB2 and NB1. So moral of the story is this thing will have already been computed here, so I would recompute it if I go with the pure recursion here. So this dynamic programming just prevents it, it saves the pre-computed values. And with that in mind, you can totally get rid of recursion, by the way. You can do everything with the dynamic programming tactic, because when basically what you count is the result with zero. So this case, 0 to the left, 4 to the right, then 1 to the left, 3 to the right, 2 to the left, 2 to the right, 3 to the left, 1 to the right, etc. So you can get those sums, those products, and sum them up. Okay. So we have discussed this. In the worst case, we will hit this ON scenario, unfortunately. Now let's do a couple of more examples. You can use a binary search tree to sort an array. Yes, it's true, because the in-order traversal gives you a sorted sequence, right? So let's go to an in-order traversal here that we discussed. Okay, so C, in-order traversal, because I go left, root, right. So I go as left as possible, which is the minimum, okay? And with that logic, I will go to the rightmost entry in the end, which is the max. So left, then go to root, which is bigger than left, so print it. Then go to right. So everything here will be bigger than 20. Okay, so do the same here. So this little box will sort itself And this part, sub part, is already sorted, and it will get merged with 20 eventually, which will get merged with 60 and then 70. So moral of the story is, in order traversal gives you the sorted list. In order traversal on a binary search tree, not a regular binary tree, obviously. Okay, so that is that. So what just happened? You need to build the binary search tree, which would take on square time, because one insertion is on, and you will do it n square many times, and then you will do an in-order traversal, which will take on time, because traversal, you will touch every node once. And if you use a good binary search tree, like a self-balanced one, then the worst case will be log n. So you will do n insertions, n log n, and the time will be n log n. But again, so far we haven't seen that self-balancing binary search trees. So you have a binary search tree. You want to email it to your friend for some weird reason, and he or she would want to recover it, restore it. So how can I do it? This is the problem. You need to save your tree into a file by making a pre-order traversal, and in the recovery time, your friend will start with an empty binary search tree and read the nodes and insert them to the binary search tree one by one. So this is algorithm to see this in action. If this is my tree, the pre-order traversal of this is, remember, root left right is the pre-order logic. So 60, 20, 10, 40, 30, 50, root done, left done, and then right 70. Okay, so this is something you put into your file. You send it over email or whatever. Then you will insert them into a binary search tree in this order. Be careful. This is the order you should stick to. So 60 comes first. Then comes 20. Then comes 10. So be careful. I first do the leftmost part, as deep as possible in the left. Then 40. It will come here. Then 30, so 30 is smaller, go here, bigger, go here, smaller, come here, 30. And then comes the 50, again left, right, right, 50. And then comes the 70, which would just land here. So see, the red is the recovery of the original black. So this just recovers the original binary search tree. How about recovering a minimum height binary search tree? Okay, then you will do the following. You will use an in-order traversal to get the sorted order. So that this will be a sorted order then. Okay. Okay. Then, where am I? Then you will make something smart. You will read the notes. So this is the smart part. So, okay. This is the in-order traversal. We know that it is guaranteed to give me a sorted array. Okay, so it happens to be consecutive numbers here, but obviously it can be different. Like it could be 10, 20, 30, 41, 52, 63, 75, etc. Right? It doesn't really matter. It should be sorted. It is the only thing. And once you do the in-order traversal, they will come to you. So this is your file. But now this is the recursive part. Put the middle to the root. Okay, so go to the middle of this array, which is 41 in this case. Okay, 41. So it is the root. Then be careful, the left of it, so 41.left, so I am using Java here, 41.left is do a binary search tree recursively with the same tactic. So what is that tactic? Do the same here, 10, 20, 30, so put the middle, which is 20 here, and do the same in the left and right. So in the left, I have only one item, nothing to build a tree about. So I will just put it here, 10, and then here, 30. See, this part just happened. And similarly, now this call, 41.set right, So you will go and get 63, the middle element, as your root. Okay, root is that node. And you will call recursively set left and set right using 52 in the left and 75 in the right. So this is how you recover a binary, a minimum height, a self-balanced binary search tree. Okay, so this this is a good balanced, this is a balanced binary search tree, which has a height of log n in the worst case, which is wonderful. So if you're given a particular order, you can just sort it and insert it like this to get your self-balanced binary search tree. But the thing is, in real world, in most applications, you don't have access to all your data in the beginning, right? They come in and go dynamically. So this tactic, this little 10 lines of code, will not save you. You will design a dynamically adapting, a self-balancing binary search tree that doesn't require any particular input, like sorted input or anything. And that is the topic of the next class. So that was the last slide. So I don't know where did this come from. This is the same idea, just they have used a different set of sorted array to get the balanced tree. But so this kind of ruined the moment. But what I mean is, this is a self-balanced binary search tree for a sorted input. And in the next class, we will see AVL tree, which is a dynamically adaptive self-balancing tree. It doesn't require a sorted input in the beginning. It can allow insertions and removals at any time and any ordering, with any order of the values. So it will be a very hot topic. You should stay tuned. Okay, goodbye.